My name is Mary Jane McCallum, and I'm a history professor at the University of Winnipeg and Canada Research Chair in Indigenous People, History, and Archives. Together with Robert Alexander Innes, Chair of the Indigenous Studies Department at the University of Saskatchewan, we want to focus this podcast on the early history of the implementation of mandatory Indigenous course requirements at Canadian universities, and more specifically, the Indigenous course requirement at the University of Winnipeg, the first university in Canada to institute a university-wide Indigenous course requirement. The Indigenous Course Requirement, or ICR, as we call it at the University of Winnipeg, requires that all students completing an undergraduate degree at the University of Winnipeg take a 3-credit-hour course from an approved list of ICR courses. The content of approved ICR courses have, quote, the greater part of the course content derived from or based on an analysis of the cultures, languages, history, ways of knowing, or contemporary reality of the Indigenous peoples whose homelands are located within the modern boundaries of Canada and the continental USA. Currently, about 80 courses at the University of Winnipeg satisfy the degree requirement, coming from 21 different departments. For the vast majority of students, the degree requirement is satisfied by courses offered by the departments in the Faculty of Arts and, more substantially, Indigenous studies and history. There are currently several other universities that have moved to establish several other initiatives like this: Lakehead, the University of Regina, Trent, the University of Saskatchewan, and the University of Manitoba. We might also consider the University of Alberta's Indigenous Canada massive open online course, which shares some of the objectives, but is a substantially different and far more focused endeavor that is not a degree requirement for U of A students. Discussions about ICRs range in topic from goals to oversight to staffing needs, but there is a consistent underlying premise in that these courses are a product of a university administrative will and activity. In fact, this completely misses a vitally important aspect of the story at the University of Winnipeg, where the first university-wide ICRs were implemented. Why the University of Winnipeg? When discussing the origins of the Indigenous course requirement at Canadian universities, much of the earlier history of Indigenous critique of Canadian education is kind of lobbed off. We tend instead to focus on the more direct context, the release of the interim and final reports of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which recommended that all educators, doctors, nurses, and public servants engage in Indigenous studies and Indigenous history learning. In 2016, Canada officially and fully adopted UNDRIP, the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, which is a post which is a document which explains how states are supposed to treat Indigenous people and communities and discussed the rights of Indigenous people to know and access their history. But these are universal and nationwide initiatives and do not help to explain why the University of Winnipeg in particular was able to implement the ICR when it did. The particular context of Winnipeg informed us at the time. There was substantial organizing in the I Don't Know More movement before. And the untimely deaths of Brian Sinclair, Tina Fontaine, and others had galvanized a more widespread acknowledgement of racism in the city. When Maclean's magazine published journalist Nancy McDonald's article, "Welcome to Winnipeg, where Canada's racism problem is at its worst," it seemed to shine a light on issues that were actually already being widely critiqued and discussed in Winnipeg. And it did seem to lend a sense of justification for courses which questioned and studied the innately colonial nature of certain aspects of our city's culture. But why not the University of Manitoba? At the time, at the University of Winnipeg, student government and Aboriginal Students Council were both led by an activist body of students who felt critically invested in uncovering and understanding the impacts of local, national, and global histories of indigeneity and colonialism. The ICR was not the only issue that concerned them. Many raised awareness about missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls, and documented and critiqued forms of gendered and racialized violence on campus and beyond. Then he demanded the universities and other institutions divest from funds derived from the fossil fuel industry. Then he sought to educate the public about racism in the city beyond, and beyond. Knowing a few of them, they were also likely involved in many other efforts that are not mentioned here. It's vitally important when we think about the history of the ICR to connect it to that activism of Indigenous and other students. It was undergraduate students at the university rather than the administration, and certainly rather than faculty, which developed the proposal and brought it forward to the University Senate for approval in 2015. The ICR story is told in many different ways, but the retelling of it often fails to credit the students, and in particular, the Indigenous university students who brought it forward. So two individuals I remember most in those times were Sadie-Phoenix Lavoie and Kevin Settee, and I'm so glad that they're here to talk to us about the early history of the ICR at the University of Winnipeg. Sadie-Phoenix Lavoie is Anishinaabe from Saugeen First Nation, Manitoba. They're a community organizer, graphic designer, and illustrator, artist, and poet. Lavoie is co-founder of Red Rising Magazine, a nonprofit volunteer initiative of a group of Indigenous artists, educators, youth, and allies based in Winnipeg. They are also the community coordinator of Waniskatan, an alliance of hydro-impacted community organizations, universities, and Indigenous governments that aims, through research and policy development, to explore both past and ongoing environment and human impacts of hydropower. When the ICR was introduced, Sadie-Phoenix was an Indigenous Studies and Political Science student and Vice President of External Affairs at the University of Winnipeg Students Association. They were also co-president of the Aboriginal Student Council. Lavoie was and remains an organizer on issues related to colonialism, racism, and environmental justice, and like many other Indigenous and racialized people, engages in a ton of educating in this role. Kevin Settee is Anishinaabe from the West End of Winnipeg and Matheson Island in Fisher River, Manitoba. He is a social justice and Indigenous rights activist and a storyteller through photography and filmmaking. Kevin is also a co-founder of Red Rising Magazine, and I've got the recent issue here. He is currently the writer and director of the Lake Winnipeg Project, a four-part National Film Board documentary series exploring life and culture around Lake Winnipeg. The four locations for filming are Matheson Island, Hollow Water, Morning Star Camp, Poplar River, and Fisher River. And the project has involved the use of photos, story, and social media to gather larger Indigenous family, social, and environmental histories of the Lake Winnipeg area. When the ICR was being introduced at the University of Winnipeg, Settee was an urban and inner city studies and geography student. He was also vice president external affairs and then president of the University of Winnipeg's Student Association. Thank you both for joining us today. And I want to say welcome.
Thanks for having us. That was long.
That was long. Yeah. That was long.
All right.
But it was good.
Like,
it was good.
Just like a professor.
That was awesome.
Yeah, that was awesome. Yeah, thank you for that.
So, you know, we can start off with the first couple of questions that we have is, you know, why did students do this? Why did they care about the Indigenous content requirement?
I would just say that we didn't start the Indigenous course requirement, that the ICR actually started like 10 years before we even got there. And it started, I'm pretty sure it was with, you know, the University of Winnipeg Aboriginal Student Council back then. And one of the names that comes to mind is Shanine Robinson. And so they had experiences of racism, you know, in classrooms, but also they seen, you know, those writings on the walls in the bathrooms and stuff like that of like racist graffiti, basically. And so they brought it up with the administration. And one of the things that they said that would be good would for be for students to take a course. And so that's, I guess, where it first initially started. And then it was kind of, you know, got put on the shelf in the administration and for students. And then people started talking about it again, maybe about 2 years before we got there to the University of Winnipeg Students Association.
And that's Raven Hart Bellacourt, who really stuck out and was the president at the time, who kind of brought both of us in. And that was kind of the handoff, the torch kind of gesture in a sense.
Yeah, I remember Raven invited me to a meeting one time with the, because she was the vice president of the University of Winnipeg Aboriginal Student Council. And they were working with the UWSA to develop this document. And this document was basically the proposal to the administration for the Indigenous course requirement. And so the document had like the intent, the how it was going to roll out, how it was going to be implemented, like just kind of like the finer details of what this might look like, what the purpose was, like, you know, where this university sits, how many Indigenous students there are, why this is important, and all that kind of stuff. And so I remember going to that kind of meeting and looking over this document and talking to them about it and giving them my thoughts. And then I was with the Aboriginal Student Council at that time, but what ended up happening was I actually ran for school trustee in my neighborhood in downtown West End. I didn't get in, lost by like a couple hundred votes. And then I was asked by the outgoing executives if I'd be interested in running for the student union. And I said, sure. So I ran and I got in. And then that's, you know, from that time when I got into the vice president role, you know, basically helped start taking on this work of the Indigenous course requirement.
And that was kind of when I kind of came in, as Raven was kind of showing me the ropes, and teaching me, you know, like with the Aboriginal Student Council, and she would bring me in to a lot of these situations. Like, I, you know, she would have it all already set up and planned, and I would just kind of, you know, be the second person there to provide insight and stuff like that, as a vice. And I remember that there were kind of frustrations between the UWC at the time and the ASC, which caused us to kind of figure out how we can do this in a good way together, which kind of kickstarted the work between me, as when I ran for co-president of ASC and Kevin was on VP with the UWSA. And so building that kind of alliance and moving forward in a better way where we could make a joint proposal, because we had known that there was also other work being done without our involvement, which was, you know, nothing about us without us type of motto at the time. And it was, you know, we wanted to make sure that our voices and not just student voices, but specifically Indigenous student voices were being heard in that process.
Okay, so what was going on? Like you mentioned, there's a couple of things, a couple of follow-ups. What was the impetus? Like, although there was talk about it earlier, there's something happened that galvanized the students to think about doing this at that point. And so I'm kind of wondering what's going on campus in the city. And the other thing was when you just mentioned that there's other things going on that was excluding students. Who was doing that and what was going on? But, you know, so those are a couple of questions that just popped out, have just from what you both have just said.
Yeah, totally. I mean, at the time, we all had stories of racism or some type of injustice throughout our lives. And, you know, we had a lot of history and a lot of our voices were stifled even in our classrooms, even within our academic work. And we just noticed that there was a lot of lack of attention or value towards Indigenous knowledges, especially during the time when Idle No More was happening. And there was a lot of talk around, you know, these are the contemporary issues of the time, you know, people were, you know, faced with being exposed to protests and rallies on a regular, consistent basis. Whereas before, you know, they were kind of more in a bubble in their own world and not seeing how their lives were affecting us. And, you know, even in my first week of university, I'd faced racism from somebody who said that I didn't belong there, and to say that my education was paid for by their parents, and that I, regardless of my merit or the work that I've done, there was just an automatic stereotype. There was a lot of misconceptions towards why students are trying to educate themselves. And, you know, we were constantly dealing with the battle of miseducation and the ignorance, but also just the intergenerational privilege of other students who don't see how their viewpoints had really affected, you know, our ability to really learn in a safe environment. And so, it was a hard time for a lot of students dealing with racism because they were being more vocal about it during that time, that period during Idle No More. And so that really kind of kickstarted the fire in a sense with a lot of students who kind of were rallying around this. Kevin,
you
want to share as well?
Yeah, you pretty much said what needed to be said. I don't have anything to add on top of that. Yeah.
What was the other part of your question? Sorry, I'm trying to remember that part.
Well, the other part was you had mentioned that there was other things going on.
Oh yeah, yeah.
But it didn't include the students and what's going
well,
on.
Well, I don't. Well, I mean, it's. They're learning lessons for people. And, you know, sometimes there's situations where, they were well-intentioned, but they still do things in a wrong way that is unilateral in some capacity. And so what we had noticed was that the president of the UWC at the time was asked by the president of the university to have discussions with department heads around the idea of ICR, but excluding us. As a way of kind of doing a parallel version that wasn't like centered around the needs of what we were asking for. And so it just took a time to like, okay, we need to call in and educate and explain why it was important for us to have our voices be the lead in this initiative.
And how did that...
It was a learning lesson. Like we eventually came to an understanding, a mutual understanding, and realized that, yeah, even though someone in a leadership position still should take direction from Indigenous leadership.
Mary Jane?
You're muted.
Yeah. I'm just really interested in this, that context of like a kind of a backlash, right? Of the Idle No More movement. That's something I hadn't actually considered, and how it kind of plays out amongst a university population. And especially in the classroom and among students, like in class and outside of class.
I mean, it wasn't even just students. It was also teachers too, like professors and, and some people even saying that people that were marking their papers. So it wasn't just, you know, we realized that it was on all levels in all directions. So that's when we knew that it needed to be more institutional, an institutional approach, or not an institutional approach, more like, we needed to target the institution as a whole and all those facets within it.
Right. Yes, and you did. And these consultations that you talk about when you held those community meetings. I remember one that you led, Kevin, and I know Sadie and Kevin, you guys were both involved with helping other universities to do this too. But what was it that kind of gave you the motivation to do that work, to really take this on as something that was really important in your life, in your education, in your view of the way things should be in society?
Well, I'll just start by saying, like my mom was an educator. She is an educator. She still is involved in education. And I grew up in the downtown West End. And so I always felt like this university sat in my community, that this outside institution was in my community. Even though it was there before I was born, you know, this is where I grew up. This like very Indigenous community, downtown West End. A lot of Native people grew up with a lot of, you know how it is. And so, you know, being from that neighborhood, I always felt that I had a right to determine and to change the university however, you know, I felt it needed to be changed, because that's where I grew up. And I went to high school, I went to elementary. And so I know when, you know, youth like myself are going to high school and they're graduating, this is the university they're going to go to. And when I first went there, it wasn't the best place for me, you know, it wasn't what I thought it would be. And that's why it took me so long to finish my degree, because you go in there with the expectations that it's going to be a great space, and then it's not. And so there's a lot of work that needs to be done. And so when I did run and when I did get in, you know, I felt that there was an opportunity there. And so with that time that I had, that 1 year, I was going to do as much as I could. And so when, you know, when we got into that Indigenous Requirement Advisory Committee, the group that was going to implement these courses, or this plan, you know, there's a lot of administration there. And me and Sadie, we were the only student representatives. You know, we had our elders there, you know, Meyer Laramie, Dan Thomas. But, you know, administration sometimes sees students as a hindrance, or, you know, like they don't take us seriously sometimes. And so even just speaking in these meetings, it was pretty difficult sometimes, you know, like your voice would be shaking. You'd be like, oh, am I saying the right thing? Am I representing students properly? And so, you know, the number one thing for us right away was like, how do we include the community? Because this table here isn't the best representation of how this course should be implemented. These courses should be implemented. You know, you have people that some of them were from the community, but a lot of them, you know, they don't even live in the downtown area. They don't come from these areas. They don't come from these neighborhoods. So that was the first thing we did, was like, let's have a pipe ceremony. Let's invite the community to the university and just have a feast and have people come and share what they think the Indigenous course requirement should be. And so, yeah, it was the first time that we actually had, I was the first time that I seen a pipe ceremony where they were taking minutes, they're taking notes. And so it was really important. You know, I had everybody speaking there. You know, I had people coming in on wheelchairs, like, you know, these veteran Neechies, and then you had like chiefs, and then you had like street people. Yeah, there's like so many different kind of people, you know, in this meeting. And that's what we needed, that's what we wanted. And that was the first thing that we did, and we had a little document out of that. And so we used that document, you know, when we needed to in those meetings, and just to say like, hey, remember this is what was said, like we need to take this into consideration. Yeah, so that was the first part, you know, the consultation. Then we had like these other consultations that were organized by the administration, which were okay, which were good. And just everyone had so many questions, like what the hell is going to happen? Like, who's going to teach? Like so many questions, and we didn't have the answers because we were like just starting.
It's unprecedented. Like this was like history in the making, you know, like nothing had never been, you know, implemented. And so, you know, a lot of us are kind of going in with, you know, like uncertainties as the outcome is going to come. But at the same time, knowing that if we just trusted the process, or if we protected the process, then maybe the outcome could be what our desired effect, I guess. But yeah, so that was the why the like centering the consultations was super important from the beginning, to really set the tone. And like Kevin was saying, that, you know, to give us direction as to like what specific things that we should be working on and working towards, because ultimately, you know, we're responsible and we're accountable to that community, not just to the university.
So, you know, you're this is really interesting in terms of kind of working through the kind of the process, the steps towards, you know, trying to get this implemented. But, you know, in terms of like nuts and bolts, like what was it that you were actually looking for? What kind of courses would you, were you thinking that would be a qualify as an Indigenous content required course, or what wouldn't be required, and what was the process of trying to articulate those, your ideas?
I would say, like kind of going back to what the other question was about, what was happening at the time. Like he had I Don't Know More, we had a conservative government that was like really racist and like challenging a lot of, you know, chief and councils, and like with taxes and all these different things that were happening at that time. I can't even remember exactly what was happening, but I just remember there was a lot of stuff going down, and with the Water Act and stuff like that, changing the rules around the water and everything. And just like, yeah, just what we were involved in at that time, like divestment, you know, the helping to organize the powwows in the university, and like just things that were happening in our community. Like, you know, there was the MMIWG, like, you know, growing up in the West End, that's unfortunately, that's what you see, you know, and that's what you experience, and that's what's there in our community sometimes. And so, you know, I had all these different things that are happening. And so like, that's like the fuel. And that's what we want. You know, we want people to address the racism. So the courses themselves, you know, what Shanine was talking about, you know, to have like an anti-racist kind of feel to it, you know, that we're educating people about our history. And that was a big part of it. I felt like, you know, we want people to learn about our history. We want people to learn about the treaties. We want people to know like what's happening right now. And we did talk about it in that committee about, is this going to be a one course fits all, or is this going to be university wide courses that'll be in every department or as many departments as possible, and as many faculties. But another thing that we did talk about, you know, me and Sadie really pushed for, that, you know, some people might not have agreed with in the committee, was that we wanted Indigenous people to teach these courses, and we wanted the university to make a push to help Indigenous instructors, professors, to teach these courses. That was such a big thing for us. That was the biggest. Was just like, we need Indigenous people teaching these courses. Like, they should be number one on the list. And unfortunately, and I think, you know, when it started to roll out, you know, I sat on these different Senate committees. And one of them was the committees that would accept these course requirements. And ultimately, like, the Senate would be the ones that would pass these committee notes or minutes or whatever. They would, everyone would read them before they went to the thing. And I just like, I got lost in all of it, because there were so many non-Indigenous people applying for these, to teach these Indigenous course requirements. And like, they were applying for like Indigenous ways of knowing. And it's like, what the hell do you know about Indigenous ways of knowing, you know? And they're like trying to justify what they know, and like contemporary issues doesn't match with what they're talking about in their courses. And it's like, what the hell is it? Like, why is this happening? And sometimes I'd be the only Indigenous person in a Senate meeting, you know? Sometimes there'd only be two of us or three of us, and then there'd be like 40 like white people. And it'd be like, there was an Indigenous advisory committee, but they didn't have a veto, you know, over what was going to be taught and what wasn't going to be taught. And so that's another thing that we wanted. We wanted like an Indigenous oversight committee that would like thoroughly review these things. I don't think that was ever established.
I think there was like talk about it for after, but I feel like once it was implemented, people were just be like, let's see how this 1 year goes. And maybe we'll, but at that time, you know, we were already kind of exiting. So, you know, I don't know if they remembered to, or maybe they just offsetted it to the advisory committee, just because they knew that either way, they're going to need more courses the next year after. And so if anything, they were just kind of spearheading or like trying to ram a bunch of courses to get approved as much as fast as possible. And so kind of overlooking that important piece of oversight. And I mean, this was like Kevin was saying, like, you know, there was definitely an underbelly there that we had felt when it comes from the administration of their hesitancy around having Indigenous knowledge even be credited to the same standard as, Western knowledge, that we were trying to articulate with, the majority Indigenous perspective, and how are non-Indigenous professors going to be able to, fulfill that content requirement, and without, incorporating, speakers or people who are Indigenous. So it made sense. It just made more sense to why not, if you're going to be paying for these speakers to come in, why don't you just credit Indigenous knowledge and have them teach these courses? And then paying them well at the same rate and to see the same value and accreditation to the whole port. And I noticed that there was, a lot of non-Indigenous peoples claiming that they were providing that majority perspective just from, bringing other people in or using certain resources. But it was really hard to, evaluate a lot of these courses and to justify the rationale. When a lot of the times that, there was already kind of these, hesitancies, even in certain departments, some being more reluctant than others. So that too was making it a little bit more tricky to.
And I think it also brought up too, like, it would have made the administration have to be more combative with people, because, there's going to be a lot of white professors who are saying, what the hell, who's this group of Indigenous people who are monitoring my course? Like, how many people would there be like that in the university? And like, you can't even, like, even there's a few things, I remember we said a few things, so one little thing, and then there's this big thing went about it in the newspapers and stuff. And like, yeah, it was just like not censored, but just like,
yeah. I'd say censored for sure. But like even now, I still feel it.
Yeah, so and it's just like, the whole thing about, there's a lot of people in the university that, they kind of want to work their way up a ladder, and they don't want to push too hard against administration, push too hard against other people, because they'll be excluded from certain things or opportunities or stuff like that. And so sometimes these ideas that we had and these things that we were saying were just being pushed aside because the university wanted to take the easier route. And
So that was the underbelly that I was kind of talking about, that we were starting to get a sense of in these meetings. In the implementation committee meetings, was this like systemic situation at play. And ultimately it was still systemic racism, is how I see it. Because of the fact they're refusing to accredit Indigenous knowledge to the same extent. And even going so far in the effort to reach out to Dave Crescane at the Turtle Lodge in Saguin, where I'm from, and want to kind of absorb his knowledge and wisdom, but without the accreditation and without the recognition and the work that he has done in his spiritual journey, to not even be like equated to a professor, and to know that he had, in order to teach any type of course, he had to have some other professor there that had a PhD. And so he was like, why are you coming to me then? You know, like if you're coming to me and making me feel like I still need you in this process, you know. And he actually did feel really disrespected and they left, you know. And I remember hearing about that and I was very disappointed and I was really frustrated. And I remember telling Annette Trimby about that directly, was saying how would you go all the way to my res and say that your knowledge isn't equate with us? You know, it's just, I don't know if there was this, you know, disillusion or just unawareness of like how the systemic situation is at play when it came to the ICR. I think that it was more like, oh, the attention of the ICR overshadows everything else. And for us, we knew that's performative. And it was doing harm ultimately. And that was the thing that we were most, I still feel most afraid of, was the fact that I felt like I was doing more harm than good. Because if I'm trying to find a bridge or create a bridge, but it's getting, you know, it's not reaching. I'm saying, even from back forward, like we were always centering this around the community and community driven. And a lot of things that they were saying were around these things. So of course that was always going to be our priority. And it just never seemed to be a priority of the university. It was more of like, how do we make ourselves look good? And to use us and our knowledge to get there. And really, I felt really disrespected. And so like our only other option was to make it as accessible as we possibly could, and to incorporate as much as we could that with the time that we still had there, and to know that, you know, there was a lot of, you know, this is student led, but it's not like student driven or implemented in that same breath, and that the university basically took it, and ran with it and basically tokenized us. And I felt very tokenized. And I talked about this a few couple times after, whenever, you know, the university wants to do another little ICR review, I always bring this up. I had spoken this to the Indigenous Affairs Office. I had spoken this to, I think they did a survey, you know, and I'm still waiting. I'm still waiting to see like what they're planning to do when it comes to hiring more Indigenous instructors and professors and accrediting Indigenous knowledges to the same breath, divesting. There's so much there that I've just been like, it's not my responsibility anymore to make sure that that's being done, because they already know. You know, I've done my bit. I've explained. And I've gotten to the point where I felt disrespected to need to step away. And that's what's sad, because I did feel so dedicated towards the ICR. I did believe it could make a change or make a difference in some, even maybe not solve everything, maybe not solve the entire institutional situation, but maybe make a dent in enough to lessen the effect of what we had already been dealing with. And what I was afraid is that it just really just kind of shifted away. To more of a, because the students, you know, they're, you know, it their experiences is the outcome, and hearing from them afterwards, you know, when having the first year pilot year review evaluation, I remember sitting around the circle and hearing students, and they were even, you know, getting emotional, and it was really, really difficult to feel like I was associated with that. And you know, still coming to terms with that.
Emotional in what way? What's going
well,
on?
Well, like it was the, you know, like the students feeling like non-Indigenous students feeling like, oh, I'm forced to be here. Like I'm not taking it seriously, and even facing even more racism because there's more non-Indigenous people taking the classes that, you know, were mainly like a lot of Indigenous students. Who were in a hub in a sense and felt that safety around their commonality. Now they're being overly exposed and taken advantage of, and also being asked to teach these classes, like, you know, being called upon. It said, please give us the Indigenous perspective, because these courses are being taught by non-Indigenous professors who don't actually live our lives, you know. And that's the hard part, is how do you articulate a life that you haven't lived? And you know, it just makes most sense to have it centered by Indigenous voices. And you know, a lot of students were feeling that their teachers weren't explaining it right, and that they had to do the correcting. And even me, like, I ended up having to be the guest speaker at some of these courses too, after the fact. So it just seems very ironic to me.
Right. Right. Well, you know, a couple of things that's one of the things that really interests me about what happened at the UW, say, as opposed to what happened here at the University of Saskatchewan, is that this was really a student-led initiative, but not what you said, what was it? But it wasn't students who were,
not student driven,
right? So not really student driven, and it kind of seems like you feel, and you can clarify this, about the actual role that students had in implementation, and which is also kind of interesting to me too, because, you know, typically students are not really involved at all in implementation of courses or curricular kind of, you know, initiatives. So I just, you know, kind of want to hear more about, you know, your feeling about, in terms of the role that students had in implementation, that you actually had in the implementation at UW, and what role do you think the students could have or should have played in the role of implementation?
Yeah, I would say too, like, yeah, there's definitely a big difference between student-led and student-driven. And the way I think about it, it's a great idea, you know, the Indigenous coursework, and, you know, students, we helped bring it there. But then as soon as it was passed, the administration, everybody just like wanted to jump on it and like make it theirs and like pick it apart. And everyone's just I want a piece of this. Like, it's just
a piece of the pie.
Yeah, like a piece of the pie or something. Like, they want to be a part of this, and they want, you know, their name on it. They want, mm-hmm. you know, they want to, everyone wants to lead it. Like, I remember the first meeting we had, everyone was just like talking at the same time, like 10 people at the same time. Like, what are we going to do? Oh, and, like, everyone's just like losing their minds. And I was just like, hey, like, just chill out, everybody. Like, we need to chill out. Like, and
it's like a tea party in like Mad Hatter.
Yeah, that, like, that's what it was. And it was like 45 minutes of everyone like screaming around this room, like yelling, like, and everyone trying to one up each other, and like, oh yeah, it was just crazy. So yeah, that's why it was really important for us to like have these community things happening, and like mm-hmm. just trying to like clear the air and just being like, let's remember why we're doing this, where we're coming from. And then, you know, Mary Jane, you know, you're also a part of the other thing that I helped put together, which was the Indigenous requirement professors and instructors, like bring them all together to try and figure out what can we do, you know. And so that's another part of this implementation process that, you know, I wish would have continued. And so, like, if you think about it on a, like a, at an institutional level, like a University of Winnipeg level, everyone was kind of disconnected, because you have all these different Indigenous plots here and there. You have the University of Winnipeg Indigenous Student Council. You have student organizers who are Indigenous. Then you have the Indigenous faculty. And then you have instructors who are Indigenous. And then you have like the Indigenous Student Center. You have the Indigenous AVP, so Associate Vice President Indigenous Affairs Office. So you have people there. And then you have the Indigenous advisory circle, and then you have the community, you know, you have the community outside the university, like, who are also inside. And so you have all these people that are like kind of disconnected. And so, like, what I really wanted to do was like to bring these people together to make sure that we're at least meeting once a year or once every 2 years, or sorry, once every twice every year, or even more. Like it should be more. And so like, so everyone's
like quarterly.
Yeah, because no one's really on the same page, and like you need to have we need to have like a collective vision or collective goals and stuff like that. And so when I was VP external, WOB was there. And then when I became president, Kevin Lamoureux was there. And I think Sarah Dean, like she was also there like for WOB, and then she transitioned to working with Kevin. I think, yeah.
Jarita as well.
Yeah, so I mean, like, I felt like that was a big part of what needed to be done, was to carry on these meetings with these professors and instructors, with students and Indigenous, like whoever wanted to come, like that should be a normal thing that happens every twice every year. And then the other thing as well was like, what you were just talking about, Sadie, was like, you know, the after effects of these classes on students and faculty. And so what we wanted to do was like create these support groups or support circles or support centers for Indigenous students and for Indigenous professors and faculty and administration, you know, because like you have these people that are fighting for what they need in these universities and for in the community and stuff like that. And so like, you know, we kind of knew that there was going to be a little bit of backlash from, you know, non-Indigenous students, non-Indigenous professors, administrators. So like you need this group of people to be able to get together to share ideas and to plan. And a word that we use, plot, you know, you need a plotting space, you know, to make a plan of action and to figure out what are we going to do to address these issues. So like that's what we wanted to do, but that kind of stuff was not carried on, and that's what we felt should have been carried on, these types of things, these discussions, like how do we get more Indigenous professors. And I remember Lloyd Axworthy saying to me, there's not enough Indigenous instructors and professors to teach the courses here at the university. I said, I don't believe you. I said, I know there's a lot of smart.
I don't think that was Lloyd. That was, what's his name?
I had a personal discussion with Lloyd in the cafeteria.
And that's maybe that's different then.
Yeah, that's what I told him. And that was his response. And I just said, you know, like, I don't believe that. I said, I know there's a lot of smart people in our community across the country that could come here and teach. We just need to do the work to bring them here. And, yeah, he didn't really have anything to say to that.
The other guy was the co-chair of the implementation requirement with WOB. Was he like, he retired. I'm trying to remember his name, but him too. He was. Sorry.
I can see his face, but I can't remember his name.
Yeah, I can see his face. Like I could like literally visualize him saying those words.
Was it Neil Besner?
Yeah,
yes, Besner.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
And so him too was just saying that like there was not enough Indigenous instructors, mm-hmm. or that they couldn't find them. Mm-hmm. That was his other rationale, was that there's just not enough out there. And I was just like, what? And that was just like, that was just frustrating. It's just that there's like a lack of you know, will in that sense. Or like even to see the value in that, like that was always kind of pushed aside. And, you know, we were always advocating for like, you know, they need to put more money into the Indigenous faculty. You need to put more money into the department. You need to put more money in hiring, you know, way more instructors, and then like accrediting the knowledge itself. And so, and I'm like, once you do that, you're like, you have so many. And I don't know if it was just, yeah, lack of priority, ultimately. Yeah. I remember going to the support groups afterwards, like every, because then I was with, I was the VPEA. And then, you know, I remember talking to a lot of the professors, and they were always kind of coming to me with all the same, pretty much the same questions, was, am I doing this right? And it was hard to say, like, like, maybe you need to do this, or like, you know, trying to help, but I'm not an expert in every department. Like, I don't know, you know, I'm not the overall thing. And that was the thing, is that they seen Kevin and I as kind of their entry point to the community. And so they needed us to figure out how to navigate the Indigenous community a lot.
I remember being asked too to like help create classes, not create, yeah,
for them to teach.
Yeah, but like to help kind of structure like what to teach and stuff like that, and just being like, I don't know if this is the right thing to do here.
I know, that's...
this is pretty bad.
Yeah, the short answer is no. It's not the right thing, right?
But it's hard because like I don't want to be mean.
That's exactly.
Like, trying to twist it a little too hard in this one direction that like is unrelated, and that was like tricky to explain a couple times.
Once profs start to put the work on undergraduate students to do their work, you know, clearly there's a kind of a clue that perhaps this isn't the right person to be teaching this kind of a course, right?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and I'm just really curious too, like what's going on now? Because I haven't been there for a while, and just like, I'm really curious. I actually spoke a couple days ago to a UIC class, and there was good reviews there. Like a lot of students just saying like, thank you for doing this. Like I actually wouldn't probably never taken an ICR course. Actually learned quite a bit, and some of the courses that they were explaining sounded really good, like talking about like the Royal Proclamation all the way up to the MMIWG inquiry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So like every kind of class was focused on these different things in from history till now, from like a long time ago, like Treaty of New Niagara. Like, so like there's some good things, but you know, and then the other thing that, you know, me and Sadie were talking about before is like, we'd often hear this lots from not only students, but from faculty, from administration, is that these courses, this Indigenous course requirement doesn't fit with my science degree.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't fit with my science thing. And I had that same kind of statement, and they said it. It's like, it's not a question. This is like kind of a statement. That's what they said. And, you know, I had to defend the ICR and basically just say, you know, like, you're on native land. This is the bare minimum. And you should actually be happy that there's people willing to share this, you know, to do something like this, to share, because, you know, it's hard for people to find accurate information about who we are, you know, and what we're doing and stuff like that. So, and when I did share that, a lot of students did say that too, and newcomers as well, saying like, coming here, taking this course, they chose university so they could take this course. And then saying like, I learned things that I probably would never learn about Indigenous people here in Canada and North America. So there's some good things, and then there's, you know, the ignorance as well. So but yeah, I'm really curious to, like, aside from those students, like from faculty, like what's going on? Like, is it just a complete shit show behind the scenes? Like,
yeah, I'm curious too, because like, yeah, like it's been a while. I mean I graduated 2018, so it's a few years.
And
I feel like, you know, even just the contemporary times of the day have changed a little bit more, like the activist community, if you want to call it activist community, but like people on the ground are doing a lot more their own education, because of the lack of education, proper education within university institutions, and the lack of accessibility that it provides, like, and that there is a barrier that hasn't been addressed for a long time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, now trying to thinking of like, what is community education and things like that. And that's kind of been where I've been kind of moving towards, which is why, you know, like I had a dream of becoming a professor at one point. Mm-hmm. And now I was just like, you know what, I'm kind of losing faith in that institution to be able to be like, you know what, the community education, the actual real intent of the ICR you know, that was always kind of the land-based education, you know, like culture and, you know, the actual Indigenous ways of knowing and knowledge was the direction I'd preferred. But at the same time, knowing that, like, I left something that wasn't complete in a sense, you know, and I always kind of have that, like, I'm always wondering how it's going and I want to be able to help in some way, but, you know, I'm still dealing with like the after effects of, you know, even the divest situation, because that was another initiative dear to my heart that, I felt was just as important as the ICR and did not get that same amount of, respect. And even though that like the ICR had some disrespect to it, it's just the way that the ICR was used afterwards was also kind of an issue with me, because you know we were still the faces of it, we were still known and recognized, like and people, universities all over the place are asking about it and you know trying to give a positive note to it. But, you know, the thing is that I'm not going to call it positive if they're still negative. Cause it's just like, it's not there yet. It needs to be improved. It needs to be worked on. It needs that necessary attention. Because there's a whole other movement going on behind outside of the walls of the institution, which I, you know, the grassroots, where they're doing, you know, social media education, there's people like, who are giving that education out there and you know not getting that same recognition. They're not getting paid well, and you know there's a lot of barriers there, and so I feel like that community needs support. And you know that bridge has to come somewhere, but there's so much distrust with the institution because of the systemic racism, because of that does have a huge effect, and plus the energy and labor of having to talk and share and educate people who may not even want that, you know. And that was the hard part, you know, trying to get people to like want to learn and care about these things. That was, you know, something I'm still learning about, but I guess people are becoming, are like, you know, they're not putting up with it anymore. They're not putting up with, you know, even the covert racism, the subtleness, and the, you know, people are challenging and they're calling it out a lot more nowadays. And so it's like, they better fix it, because, you know, you're going to be left and it's just going to fall apart. And that's not something that for somebody that for all everybody, even the community, all their hard work and knowledge that they have given the university is a gift ultimately. And how are they taking care of it? You know, that's the other thing. It's like, well, was it worth all that effort if it's just going to fall onto the shelf again? Because, you know, there wasn't that dedication that we should have seen or that we expected. And I guess in a way that it's that uncertainty and like is why I haven't been paying attention, because I was kind of like, I'm scared to hear if there's more bad things, like because I want it to be good.
Yeah,
but I feel like I've put so much energy into this, you know, and at some point I'm like, where is the university actually taking responsibility and holding themselves accountable to that? And to know that it's not just us that are the ones that have to keep it alive. You know, me and Kevin, you know, bringing us on every once in a while. It's just like, you know, you really got to commit and really got to understand what we were saying from the very beginning and go back to that. Because, and if you need to restart and refresh, you know, there's things there that need to be improved. And, you know, it's at some point it's the university isn't going to be able to hide it, because the students are going to speak out about it at some point. Yeah. You know, that's something that, you know, we've always done.
This is such, and like the ICR and divestment were just like a small part of the work that we did as well.
Totally.
And yeah. I always tell people, like, the 2 years that I spent with the Students Union was probably the hardest I ever worked in my life.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Like, literally, like, from 8 a.m. in the morning sometimes to like midnight.
Yeah. Even past midnight.
For months at a time. And yeah. Like,
Student Union like runs a daycare and like it does a ton of different
stuff. Yeah. And there's like a million meetings and stuff, and you kind of have to pick and choose which one you got to go to.
My grades actually went down because of it.
And so it was just like, nothing compares to the amount of work that we put in there, and the amount of passion that we put into that work too. Like, it was like, you know, we really, really changed our lives to make a difference in these 2 years that we were there. Mm-hmm. And there's other stuff there too, like, you know, consent culture. There was, you know, the climate change work that we were doing, like helping to raise awareness about land defense that was happening.
Yeah, grassroots.
Organizing events, speaking, and then, you know, starting Red Rising magazine at that time. And then you had Racialized and Indigenous Student Experience Summit. And then you had like provincial meetings, and we had federal meetings.
The national meetings of the CFS. The stuff that's going on like in the community outside of school.
And then Sadie was like international, like going to Europe and like Africa.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I mean, like, there, it was just like, you know, a lot of work and a lot of energy and a lot of stuff went into this. And it's just like, I sometimes think that the university doesn't even know like how much we love this place, you know, this place where we come from, these communities, and how much we want to make things better for more students that are coming and for the faculty. And so, yeah, it was a lot of work, a lot of stress. And I'm always kind of curious as to what's happening. And because I don't really, not that I'm not paying attention, but I just, you know, haven't, I'd like to know. I'd like to, like, maybe that's something the university should commit to doing, like an annual, you know, what's happening with the ICR.
Yes, like, totally.
Like, even if it's just like an hour long thing or a 2 hour long thing, not a report, but like, you know, people talking, people saying, well, maybe it can be a report. Maybe they should be, you know, giving numbers of like how many students there are and like how much faculty, you know, these percentages, because that matters. Like, I'm working at the NFB, and like, I think it's like below 1% of the people that are working there are like Indigenous, like below 1% that are actually hired, like working full time. So, I mean, like, those numbers kind of matter.
They matter.
And the community doesn't forget that either. Like, they don't forget what had happened. And I'm sure if we're curious, then, you know, times that by 10 with the community, is kind of how I see things. And, you know, at the time, it was a very dark time for us as a community, even though that there was a lot of hope. You know, we were dealing with so much adversity, like on all fronts, and it was, you know, a scary time and it still is, you know. And the whole ICR, like, the whole intention was to kind of give people kind of this hope and to like kind of lighten it up and you know, show that, you know, we want to make that difference, we want to make that change, and that we're passionate about it, course. And they see that work, but then they're like, well, now what? And, you know, it's just kind of where the momentum go, and whose responsibility is to hold up that and can to keep moving forward, because it can't just, you know. I still want to hold hope for the ICR, like, without a doubt. And I know a lot of other people, a lot of other institutions are figuring out how that may work for them. No, and we knew that, like, you know, that process was always kind of tailored towards the UW. And, like, you know, we never really thought about how that would ripple out until it happened. And went with Lakehead and how different theirs were at the same time. And then moving forward to when we were with, you know, the Canadian Federation of Students and doing talks and talking with other student leaders, you know, and hearing their feedback, and their criticisms, you know, it allowed us to kind of come back and say, hey, you know, we still need to sort these things out, because, but, you know, like Kevin was saying, we were so busy. Like, how much energy can we offer you know, and the fact that, I mean, you get paid in the UWSA, but anything else outside of that, you know, is, you know, it's just, it's fueled by our passion. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we're always having to figure out, like, how can we, how do we value people and the work that they had put into it, moving forward as well.
That's really interesting. So Rob and I had planned to actually make this two-part series where the second part actually talks with faculty about the implementation of the ICR. So we're hoping to kind of cover some of the questions that you've got about what's going on now in that. I can just give you a brief sense, like our department has, I mean, this is the positive story, right? It has absolutely revolutionized our department. Our curriculum used to be that a first year history student would take Canadian history survey. Now a first year history student takes Indigenous history. We used to have a very particular kind of population in our history courses, and you're familiar with that population. Now our history courses represent like a cross-cutting of the entire university because everybody has to take it, right? So we get these really amazing, representative, diverse student populations in the courses. As for Indigenous students, usually their percentage within the course has gone down because there's more courses, right? So there are more courses where they are, and there's more people in the Indigenous courses, right? So that does change their experience. But yeah, the U of W, I think, like, I don't think it's good to think of it as a positive or a negative. It's both. Like, it's always going to be both. There's always going to be this tremendous positive, you know, energy and commitment and knowledge and an effort to have, like you say at the beginning, like nothing without us or nothing about us without us, nothing that we are not kind of making decisions about and having authority over. But like, there's always this negative too, right? And you can dwell on that for sure. And I have before, and we might a little bit in part two as well. What I really like about both of your messaging is that your initial efforts were really about community building at U of W. And that's like, I think what we really need right now. Like we need to like pick up some of those initiatives that you had suggested that went along with this, right? About bringing the community and faculty and staff and student services and all of those people together and meeting and talking, you know, every once in a while, like making sure that there's that community there. But yeah, the actual implementation, like I'm curious about what your ideal course was. Like you've talked about having it be focused on Indigenous knowledge, but also like there's this sort of anti-racism angle too about history, especially like Indigenous studies and history courses, that content kind of tries to challenge people maybe in some of the stereotypes or assumptions they have about Indigenous people. Like, did you have a preference for models or like in your mind, did you take a course that you thought, oh yeah, that would be good if everybody took that course? And sometimes it's that you have a bad course, right? And you're like, I really don't want to have that be, you know, in the university anymore. I want this instead. Like, this is my ideal.
Go ahead.
I would just say that, like, I think that also was like a big discussion in the meetings was like pedagogy, like how are these classes being taught? Like, are we sitting in rows? Are we like, because like Indigenous learning is like lifelong learning, and you don't stop learning till you die, and you go to the spirit world, and you're still helping and learning, and it's just like, it's so like I think we knew that you can only learn so much with the course that was going to be taken, like a 3-credit-hour course. So you know that there's limits there right away, you know, with the content, with the amount of stuff that they can learn, but also you're not getting the full Indigenous, you know, paradigm kind of experience of learning, of, you know, that lifelong learning and just, yeah. So I think we all kind of knew that was a thing, but, you know, for me, the most impactful courses were like learning about colonization, learning about colonialism, and then also Indigenous ways of knowing with my, so like Larry Morissette, his classes that I took were just like, you know, groundbreaking for me. Meyer Laramie's classes that she taught, Jim Silver's classes about, you know, the North End and Winnipeg and you know, how he taught those courses and, you know, really taught us about poverty and the complex poverty and the neoliberalism and capitalism and, you know, how the cities change, community organizations that are doing good work, like, and really kind of like even shifting our own perspectives of our own communities. Like we grew up with these organizations like, you know, Mamaway and Kani Kani Chick and stuff like that. But, you know, there's a lot of different organizations for a lot of different people who are going through a lot of different things. So like learning about these things about our communities is like really important, and how to be in these spaces and learn in these spaces. But yeah, the other thing that I would share too is like, we knew that these courses were going to be spread out throughout different faculties and departments. And so, there'd be a lot of different opportunities for people to learn different ways, learn different things. Yeah, but I would just say like number one course was Aboriginals and Colonization with Larry Morissette. That just like broke my mind and put it back together. And
we were both in that same class.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that was a great class. And Larry had a good way of teaching and like basically just a book in our hands and conversation.
Was it Indigenous that he was teaching? Was it Indigenous Studies course?
It was UIC.
I think it was a cross list with UIC and Indigenous Studies.
Yeah. And there's non-Indigenous, you know, people in that class too. And he gave it to them. Like, like truth. They got the truth.
What level was that course? Was it a first year course or second?
I think it's a second.
Second or third year.
Second or third, yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, it was just hard hitting, truthful. The other course that I took for me that was good for me personally, like, was residential schools, because my grandmother went to residential school and we actually talked about the school, and I wasn't expecting it. And then I was just like, and then we had this, I was telling the UIC like students, I said, we got this list of intergenerational effects of residential schools, and I was going through them and I was like, that's me. That's me. Oh yeah, that's my dad. Yeah, that's for sure my dad. Oh, okay, that's why he used to do that.
I think I still have that list somewhere.
Yeah, so I mean, like, some of these courses are good for, like, you know, us as Indigenous students. Yeah. Some of them might not be as, you know, impactful to non-Indigenous students. Maybe they would be. But definitely looking at colonialism, looking at the relationship, looking at white supremacy, looking at the oppressed, the oppressor, the usurper, the usurped, the colonizer, the colonized, the
Albert Memmi
situations that we live in. Yeah. And just, yeah, just
was that residential schools course, was that Lorena Fontaine's Indigenous Studies?
Yeah. It was the legacy of residential schools. Yeah. Oh, Lorena Fontaine. Mm-hmm.
So that was an important class. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just feel like UIC is the best. Just like,
I only took like, I took UIC as like, you know, if they're cross listed and then as electives, but I was like, man, I should have just double majored in that. Because politics was something else, let me just say. Dealt with a lot of racism in those classes, but yeah, I guess for me, like, yeah, colonialism was always kind of like the biggest thing, just because of the, you know, obvious work that we were doing, and like, you know, me being directly involved in, like, you know, organizing, community organizing. You know, that was always beneficial to me, because at least then it was like giving me kind of the tools to kind of understand the like the ways that colonialism comes out. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the main reasons why I took political science, was because I wanted to understand the political system and how it affects us. You know, I wanted to map it out. I wanted to map out colonialism so that I could start targeting things in there.
Yeah.
Which is why I like a lot of the work that I do is in so many areas, is because, you know, I've tried to do research and how, you know, on all levels of systemic and interpersonal and individual racism and privilege play out. And so, like, for me, like, I always like things that were always very immersive. I liked a lot of the field studies. I know that Tasha Spillett was like focusing on like kind of like land-based education, and I was super excited about that. And what does that like look like? And, you know, kind of totally revolutionizing what we see as Indigenous education. The way I saw it was that the university shouldn't have any control whatsoever as to how the outcomes or like what we want to envision Indigenous education or Indigenous knowledges and how that pedagogy works. And so in a lot of ways, it was taking people outside of the classroom and putting them into the community, you know. And I remember even with the ICR consultations, people were saying like, why don't we get like kind of like community service hours and stuff like that, where people actually do volunteer work in the communities and start building relationships and stuff like that, and you know, the academic piece is kind of their journaling or reports and stuff like that as to what they had learned. And, you know, like I like those types of things where you're graded based on your outcome of like what you've actually absorbed and unlearned within, you know. And so challenging the white privilege, mm-hmm. anything that challenged white supremacy, white privilege, racism, and colonialism. But the other thing was focusing around social movements and how to build community, how to you know, see intersectionalities and play out with BIPOC communities. Mm-hmm. You know, seeing, I would love courses that would talk about, you know, Black resistance, mm-hmm. and Indigenous solidarity, you know. And that's kind of where the community is kind of shifting, you know, from when we were involved, everything we did was always like Indigenous until we started RISE. And then after that, we realized that we need to start doing our own work in building those bridges with other social movements. And so like, I love courses like that, you know, things that actually, because when you go to university, you know, we're paying for it, even if it's funded by our bands. Yes. And so we should have some say as to what we want to have outcome, you know, and what we want to get out of these courses, and have some say into how they're being designed. Mm-hmm. And so that was the kind of my whole premise with the ICR, was that we should have had creative control as to how these knowledges are utilized to reach out to non-Indigenous peoples and to build solidarity with other oppressed groups.
Yeah.
That was kind of how I saw it. And I mean, it would be awesome if there was like even a nonviolent direct action camp field study in some way,
yeah.
where they brought in people and talked about how to be safe on the front lines, you know, because that is the reality, that there are people, it's about making the education useful, mm-hmm. to the contemporary times of what we're dealing with right now, and that the ICR should still shift with the community as it moves and changes over time, like the community discourse, the political discourse. So it always has to be coming, you know, has to be continuously being reviewed and seeking feedback from that community.
Yeah, and that's where the Indigenous professors and instructors being involved is so important, because they kind of have a pulse of what's happening, and they know what's happening in the communities, and they can adjust their courses to address what's happening right now, like what's happening in the communities right now, like what's happening on the West Coast. You know, can they explain what's happening with the Trans Mountain expansion pipeline? Mm-hmm. You know, Kinder Morgan, can they explain, you know, what these youth are doing, why they're doing it? Can they find those connections to help those youth speak into their classrooms, you know, like that's vital things that need to be taken into consideration when who's teaching these courses. And like, I took a community organizing class, I think it was. And like, we had to walk, we weren't really allowed to drive or bus to these places. Like it was part of our course to like walk to these places. So like walking through the North End, Central, Downtown, West End. And I remember this one time we were walking as a class and there was this guy laying on on the side of the street on Higgins Avenue by the Graffiti Art Gallery. And like all the students like didn't know what to do. And they were just like, they were kind of like scared. They're like, oh my God. And they like cross the street. And so like me and my brother, we walk over and we're like, hey man, what's going on? And, you know, and we pick him up, like we help him get up and pull his pants up and zipper up his jacket. And you know, like that's a teaching moment for these students, you know, like being outside on the, like literally just being on the street, walking on the streets, you know, like getting outside of the classroom. It's like so important. And, like that was a teaching moment for people, you know, like you see somebody on the street, you don't just leave them there, help them, you know, help to check on them. Are you okay? And so, yeah, like, you know, what Sadie was saying, like with pedagogy, like there's so many more opportunities to think about how we can learn as students in the university and outside the university. And yeah, I remember professors also saying, or the administration saying that like, the cost of doing these field courses is a hindrance, like a big hindrance to making these things more available. And we were just like, no, I don't, like, if there's got to be a way to support teachers who want to teach these courses and do these courses. You know, you just need to plan it out, plot it out, figure it out, work it out. And
it makes it easier when you're even connected with that community, you know, because then you know who to go to when even sorting it out. And like, I know we talked about how, like, where does our like cultural spirituality kind of play in all this? I know we had talked about like Sweat Lodge before on campus, and, you know, but making sure that things were done in the right way. And I think it might have probably would have been better to like, yeah, maybe it would have been best that we held out on that because of a lot of uncertainty as to how it would have been respected was the other thing. Bringing ceremony into the space and not knowing like how the instructors would, you know, like, I don't know, there's just so many like uncertainties there, like, and but the idea was always great because it was, you know, it's bringing people in to kind of get that experience and to feel it for themselves in a sense. But now that I think about it, like back, it's like, I just don't want it to be like the scene is this like voyeurism, Indigenous voyeurism, where people are like, I'm going to take this class so I can actually take a sweat, you know, and like not understand the seriousness of our ceremonies. And part of that was always kind of worried about like, maybe there's some things that should be reserved that don't have, that can't be in that space just because of the institution itself. And so that's why the field study was kind of like, well, maybe we can still kind of bridge it in some way, but seeing how as to how they treated like Dave at the Turtle Lodge, because that was going to be seen as kind of one of those things where bringing students to the lodge to learn and so forth, and you know, and not going so well, it's kind of makes you worry, you know, like you know, you kind of second guess and you question. And then you have other land-based education programs like the Shinta University in the Northwest Territories, I believe, who did not like the ICR at all. Like I met people, I think I was in Ottawa, and they were like, yeah, we're not a fan. We're not a huge fan of what you guys did. And I was like, I'm sorry. I was like, I like what you guys did. That's kind of what I wanted. And so that was, you know, because they're actually hands-on, like on the land, learning, you know, how to tan hides, how to, you know, trap and things like that, which I thought was like, you know, we need to learn how to survive on the land. Like that alone is super important. And we don't get that information, especially for like people living in a city. Like I have felt so privileged having that knowledge. And I was like, how can I share that? Like, you know, and how can we create space for those things to happen and to have that knowledge exchange? You know, that's in order to garner the appreciation as to why we are connected with the land, why we protect it, have all those things kind of play out in it. But at some point I was just kind of like reluctant because I don't know if the university was well intentioned in respecting those pieces, you know.
This is just fascinating to me. And I know that we've probably like picked your brains for far longer than we like wanted to, but I just can't help wanting to listen to more, because it's really informative and it's a good reminder of what the intentions were, and what to keep an eye on. For us, and to what to bring back into our conversations that maybe has been lost. But I did, you know, I don't want to keep you too much longer, but I did want to ask if there was anything that you wanted to say or talk about or mention or bring up that we didn't actually already bring up. And that's you too, Rob. You can...
Watching YouTube videos.
Yeah, you guys are all over YouTube.
No, I'm just kidding. I don't know. What can I say? I feel like we covered so much.
Yeah, we really did. We really did. We got a really good sense of the history, I think, and a lot of like. Rob and my conversation has been a little bit different, like really more from the kind of institutional perspective and the kind of lived realities, day-to-day realities of like, you know, what you need to go through to teach and yeah. And like questions about governance and of this kind of initiative too. And we'll probably like be able to get into that more in part two. But like, you know, we disagree on several of these things, even among Indigenous faculty and staff and administration. There's still lots of debate about these things. Yeah.
I would just say that like, as like a student organizer, it was good to have support from faculty. Like, well, not even, well, yeah, support, but even just being there, like physically having people come and show up and be there, you know, for different things that are happening. And the other thing, not really, I guess it is kind of related to the ICR, is the, like how much I learned from other students as well, like learning from the professors and these courses, but like, I learned so much from other students and being a part of the UWSA and the Canadian Federation of Students. And like I said, the ICR there, it was a big part of what we did and stuff, but like, I feel like we were just getting to where, like, if we could be there for another year or two or three, like we could have helped do so much more, you know, like and what Sadie talked about with RISE was like, it was called the Racialized and Indigenous Student Experience Summit, where it was like racialized students, Indigenous students from across Manitoba, from across the country coming together. That was like the most radical space that I've ever been in my life. That is honestly like, I love being in those spaces so much, learning about people, talking to people, like making new friends and like exploring the city and like being in the streets. Like that was like some of the best times of my life. like being with other racialized and Indigenous students from across the country in Toronto. And then like to bring that back to Winnipeg and to do some like smaller kind of RISE gatherings, like, because that really like, that's the groups that need to come together in the university to make change. Yeah. Like Indigenous people can't do it on their own. You know, Black students can't do it on their own. Like we need to come together and like make these changes. And yeah, even when we were like occupying INAC, you know, like the thing that inspired me to go and help and organize and get involved with that was, you know, Black Lives Matter showed solidarity in Toronto. And I was like, oh man, if Black Lives Matter is going and, you know, supporting, you know, the Mohawks there and the Indigenous people over there, like we should be doing the same thing here. Mm-hmm. And so that really pushed me to be, you know, a better community member and a better student and to help get involved with that kind of stuff. So that's one thing that I would say is that, like, you know, the university is great, you know, the courses are great, but I learned so much from the students, other students from across the country. And I would encourage, if there are students here listening, like that are going to listen to this podcast, like to get involved and help organize and like carry on the work. And yeah, so that's what I would share. And yeah, no hard feelings to like administration or like, you know, professors and stuff like that. Like, this is our work. This is what we believe in. And it's not a personal thing. At times we should have made it personal, but we didn't. No, it's
personal.
Take it personal.
Yeah.
I do too. I try not to, but yeah.
Yeah. It's too much for me. It's just too much energy to do that. And sometimes I feel like you just give so much, you know, to these spaces that we need to keep some energy for ourselves. And eventually they're going to have to listen, you know, they have to listen or, you know, shit's only going to get worse.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the one thing that I really want to like convey is that the ICR can't be a standalone. And that there has to be a lot of other things that are incorporated with it that are very much tied to the university. And like, as I was saying, like before, you know, like the funding, the accreditation, those are all really important, the connection to community, but also the role that it plays and the symbolism that it has and the connection that it has with the community can be overshadowed by its direct like involvement with like fossil fuels. 100%, you know, it can't be engaged in the form of colonialism, because you're never going to get the full support by community. Like, people are always going to be acknowledging the hypocrisy of that, and I really hope that the university does take it seriously when it talks about anti-colonial work. And the role that it plays as an education institution that is directly investing in the destruction of our livelihoods. And I've said it countless times, and it's because, you know, like if the university really wants to be a genuine tool against colonialism and against, you know, the history of racism and miseducation, around what had happened to us, it needs to discontinue contributing to that harm. And because like what's talking about harm that you're also contributing to and still gaining money from it? Like, there's just so many problems there. And, you know, like, I am tired of like performatism. I'm tired of, you know, tokenizing. I am tired of, you know, co-opting the work and energy that others have put in, only for it to fall short. And to know that, like, the same level of passion from the beginning needs to continue. You know, a lot of the work that me and Kevin done in the community and trying to be mentors and show people that they should stand up and fight for this, you know, it only just shows that there's going to be other people besides us who are also going to request it. You know, just because we're not heavily involved doesn't mean that other people, you know, to make space for them, to listen to their voices, to listen to the new generations that are coming up that are demanding the same things that we've been saying for how long. And just because it's not coming from us doesn't mean that it doesn't matter. You know, just because we were started doesn't mean that we're going to see the end in a sense, but to carry it on, because our perspectives aren't the only perspectives, and that it really needs to connect with the ground. And a lot of, especially the youth who aren't able to come to university at all, especially those ones, because how can you be accessible? How can you be educating? How can you claim excellence when, you know, you're contributing to classism, you're contributing to those systemic barriers? You know, it really needs to look at the way it's the way their system is made up, and how to increase that accessibility for Indigenous youth, because they owe it to us, because they had contributed to the destruction. You know what I mean? So yeah, I mean, I still have hope. I just don't see it happening so fast, because like I feel like at some point the university just kind of waited for us to leave. And, you know, they have these strategic maneuvers, procedural maneuvers that they use against our voices, that they need to really change. This whole Kerr and King, Robert's Rules of Order is BS.
Kerr and King.
I'm so frustrated. Kerr and King book, just to prepare for a meeting and then still getting slammed down by procedures. And, you know, and the fact that I told the university, I'm like, I'm literally giving you a choice to either colonize me or not to colonize me. And they still decided to colonize me with the divestment. And I said, like, if that's the case, then I don't want my name associated with ICR. Like, I'm so annoyed that you're using that and our faces attached to it when I'm already like, you know, I'm being colonized by you. Like, mm-hmm. It was kind of how I felt. And, and for it to be by Annette Trimby, like as a Métis person, I'd just be like, where's the solidarity? And I hate to say names, but I'm like, you know what? I'm not associated with the university anymore. I want to like say my feelings as much as I possibly can, because hopefully, you know, maybe it'll go, maybe it'll happen. Maybe somebody will be like, you know what? You're right. And I want to continue doing that work too. Because I think the university has a lot of work to go. That still has a lot of work to do. They're just starting. Maybe I'm just being impatient, but you know, I want to see better results.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I definitely agree that this was never to be. The ICR was never at U of W presented as a ends of itself, right? Like this was never supposed to just be just about the ICR, right? This was also about a politics that was around the ICR that included divestment. We got the ICR through. Like that was a major achievement, right? We are not at the point of divestment yet, but the struggle does continue. It mm-hmm. continues there. So, and this also plays a role, this history that we're doing now, it plays a role in reminding people of that. And it's really important, I think, to do that work. And so I just really appreciate your time and your thoughts and for answering all of our questions in this forum, and for letting us tell or use our platform, Sago Neechie, to kind of tell that angle of the story, which, yeah, it's known at our university, but it's actually not very well known outside of it, outside of the ICR circles that have invited you to their institutions and things like that. So it's such an important history, I think.
Thank you. I appreciate it.